Aho, bonjour, Nikan. My bone. My name is Minisa Crumbo, and my father was the Potawatomi Indian artist Woody Crumbo. What follows is a part of my story about us. I hope you enjoy it.
Whenever God created man, why then man became a co-creator with God, because man began to create things too. And each time a person creates something, especially in my way of thinking, why, he has to put a spirit with it, because it's projecting his own self into it. So when a person paints a picture, if he has the right feeling and his aims and all towards his depiction, if everything is all right and he's successful, he has given that picture a spirit.
We are Anishinaabe of the Great Lakes Three Fires Confederacy, made up of the Odawa, Ojibwe, and Bodenwadmin nations. Great-grandmothers and grandfathers, our ancestors, walked the wild rice lands following the sacred shell prophecy. We came to occupy lands from historic Nova Scotia to the Chicagosh, or onion fields of Chicago. The removal nation of Kansas, Indiana, and finally the citizen Potawatomi Nation of Oklahoma with this agency in Shawnee. Coming near the end of the Potawatomi tribal relocation program, the young Crumbo family arrived in Shawnee, Oklahoma from St. Mary's, Kansas to receive their allotment of tribal lands in 1900 while Oklahoma was still Indian territory. Woody Crumbo's mother, Marianne Hurd, was descended from Archange Chevalier and Louise Wilmette. Woody's father, Alexander Crumbo, was the firstborn American child of Alexander and Wilhelmina Crumpel, recent immigrants from Halberstadt, Germany. It was on this land, near Lexington, Oklahoma, that Woody was born, the youngest of nine children. But soon, the young man was to find himself on his own.
My mother died when I was seven, and my father died shortly after that. But I didn't live with any relatives at all. After my mother died, I just took off and got lost. Western Oklahoma and all around, wherever there's Indians, and because I was always seemed to be welcome with most any group of Indians, because Indians have a thing about young people, kids, that they take them in and raise them as their own, you know, as long as they want to stay. And they treat them like part of the family. That's the old way that they used to do it. So that's the reason that I had learned so much about different Indians and different tribes and things of that kind. We're simply living with the different groups and taking part in their ceremonies. So I guess I was considered myself lucky, even though I wouldn't consider myself lucky to lose my parents. I was lucky in the way that I chose to go, because I got to live with some very interesting people while I was a young person growing up.
The young man began early in life to follow the Potawatomi wandering blood and build his spirit talk and walk, which was drawn from the rich early statehood mix that was then Oklahoma. Almost all of the elements and cultures were fairly recent arrivals to the Red Earth, Oklahoma, itself being a Choctaw word from which the new state would identify and name itself, Red Earth. Many of these early years were spent with his sister Phoebe Gregg and her family in Sand Springs, Oklahoma, and the George Island family in Sapulpa, Oklahoma. It was from Sapulpa that Woody was sent to the Federal Indian Boarding School in Chilaco and never made it back.
When I went to the Indian schools, and like all Indian schools, it was against the rules for any Indian student to sing an Indian song or talk Indian in his own language or paint an Indian picture or to have anything to do with the Indian type heritage. And there's many, many students got in some pretty serious trouble just by painting an Indian picture. Since it was against the rules and everything for Indians to paint Indian subjects or do their dances and all, why, the Indians, of course, complied with the rules, and therefore a lot of this culture was lost.
Woody spent much time with members of the Kiowa tribe in the western part of the state. He was adopted by them and learned many things. One of the enduring gifts that came down through time from them was the gift of the sacred flute. In his later years, he returned that gift to the Kiowa Nation. And it was from there he began other schooling at Fort Sill Indian School, Wichita University in Kansas. And in 1938, he received his degree from the University of Oklahoma in Norman.
Well, I first became interested in Indian art when I went to the Indian schools, and then I met some Kiowa Indian boys there, and I went home with them, and this was when I was in the grade school. And while I was there, I got acquainted with Susie Peters, and she stimulated me to become interested in painting Indian pictures, or pictures of Indians. And she had started the Kiowa boys, five Kiowa boys and one girl, to painting, and they'd been painting for very few years. And so I became interested because at the Indian school I'd gotten interested in painting because I would paint Indian heads on the back of raincoats and jackets and things like that. And I would be paid maybe $1 or $2 for this, for each picture. And so I just kind of became interested in Indian art because I danced with the boys there, and we'd traveled all over the country doing Indian dances. And I liked the ceremonies and all the things that went with it.
In the Indian nation, the cowboy's life was my occupation. In the Oklahoma hills where I was born.
The Native American tribal locations, the European extract land rushers and settlers, and an outlaw tradition settled onto the prairies and grasslands and deep into the hardy blackjacks of what had very recently been the lawless IT or Indian territory, adjudicated from across the Arkansas River in Fort Smith, Arkansas, by the upright hanging Judge Parker, as he came to be known. Woody interfaced squarely with each of these colorful blocks of early citizens. His way became grounded in the Indian traditions, but he also heard stories that Jesse James and other outlaws had roosted as close as Turkey Mountain, just across the river from Sister Phoebe's home in Sand Springs. The cowboys, ranchers, farmers, merchants, cotton pickers, oil field roughnecks, sweetgrass burners, gourd dancers, shawl swingers. They all walked the red dirt roads, black townships, and Indian towns together. This is where Woody began to make his spirit talk, his conversations of balance and harmony with the Creator. The natural world was the enduring source of his inspiration throughout his entire life. The Mother Earth and Father Sky Sun and all of the beings and powers that live upon and within were the true enduring subjects of interest throughout his life.
And anyone that sees my work knows full well that I'm not trying to make a realistic picture. You see, a good artist should never try to paint everything just exactly like it is. You don't do that, might as well take a photograph of it. So with the impression, an artist leaves an impression and something for the viewer to supply himself. Because if everything's there, that thing is not interesting. And it's that little bit of elusiveness that the artist has left out, either by choice or by being incapable of putting it all in there. And then the viewer can come along and pick up the vibrations of the artist and supply the rest of the picture.
His documentation of ceremony and regalia brought forward the beauty of Indian culture. The dancers and ceremonies show us how things might have been. The animal and nature paintings show us, again, that this, the Mother Earth and Father Sky Sun, are our first, most beautiful and enduring gifts from the Creator. It was these ways, new and old, that informed Woody Crumbo's world and contributed to his inclusive and diverse worldview that would give his painterly legacy of making spirit talk and shows us that his life was his dance. Oh, he's good. He's very, very good. And that dance came to be articulated through the influence, support, and help of his many teachers. His early training continued with the influences of Creek, Kiowa, tribal elders, Thurlow Lawrence, the great composer of By the Waters of Minnetonka. He began to study with the renowned muralist Olin Nordmark, a Swedish artist who oversaw the interior building commission that was to be where Woody first came to national notice and prominence.
And Olin Nordmark, he was a Swedish technician that the government Indian office had hired to teach Indian artist techniques in painting and mural painting and etching. In my case, he was a specialist in etching. So
We stayed at
Fort Sill Indian School while I was studying the etching, and he was there. And then there at that same time was a number of artists like Alan Hauser, Gerald Naylor, and Steve Mulpope, Spencer Asai, Jack Hokey, and then there was Archie Black Owl. There's quite a number of Indian artists that became very prominent after that stayed there at Fort Sill Indian School and did paintings, worked with Mr. Nordmark on techniques.
By early 1939, he was one of six artists commissioned to paint the federally sponsored murals during the Depression. The other artists were members in part of his early cadre of Kiowa Five. Each of these young muralists went on to become well-known and prolific artists in their own fields. Shortly after the Department of Interior mural project, Crumbo installed a mural illustrating the gift of the Cherokee written language to the people from Sequoia or George Guest. This piece is in the Sequoia log cabin in Salisaw, Oklahoma. Another piece, The Rainbow, has hung in the Nowata, Oklahoma post office since 1941, depicting multiple horses and riders acclaiming at the sight of a rainbow. Another, a peyote ceremony mural, continues to evoke the sacred from the walls of the Philbrook Art Center in Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Hey, you win.
over the original entrance of the Gilcrease Museum has been assigned to an early octave with museum expansion that flies in and out of sight with use as a logo. It was here that Crumbo first introduced the enduring subjects of the peyote bird, the ritual of the sacred flute, social scenes depicting ceremony and costume, and his renowned wildlife scenes. He was to be known for these subjects throughout his long and prolific career as a Potawatomi Indian artist. And soon after serving as director of the art department at Bacon College in Muskogee, Oklahoma, where he designed and completed the peyote-inspired stained glass window in the chapel.
I did some designs for stained glass window. Of course, I didn't follow that as a trade. The church in Muskogee at Bacon, they're building this nice new church there. So I designed the windows for that church out at the Bacon College. And
And is it on the grounds there?
Yeah, it's on the grounds there. The rose window is, I think, 13 or 14 feet across. It's up over the baptistry. I think it's very beautiful. I like to look at it.
Did you get your idea from the rose window and that?
No, I got the idea from the peyote.
You did?
Yeah, it's a peyote window. I even have the peyote birds in it and the altars and the Christ, which is represented by the plant. It's a beautiful thing. Of course, I never told anybody that it was a peyote window. I just made a beautiful window, but most of the Indians knew it anyway. When they look at it, they could see it.
The Indians get it.
Yeah, the Indians got it. And sometimes they used to...
But that is a peyote bird then.
Yeah, well, I had the four directions, you know, and all. And sometimes the old folks, Indians, would come and they'd stand in front of that window and make prayers because they thought it was real nice to see some of their own designs and something that they believed in and had accepted from the white man, the story of Christ, and then to see it in church that in a way that they could understand it. And with their own type of symbolism. See, the Christ symbolically is like a cross. That's a Christian religion, it's a cross.
And so
the peyote is like a representation of Christ.
Mm-hmm. The bread makes it.
Well, the peyote itself, you know, is kind of like a sacrament. And So it's all, like I said a while ago, just a very, very good rendition in Christianity.
At this time, Woody, the young silversmith, muralist, painter, printmaker, stained glass artisan, and flute player, traveled to New Mexico to work and study at IAIA, the Indian Arts Institute of America in Santa Fe, New Mexico. It was here that he met our mother, Lillian Faye Hoag of Pierce, Oklahoma. She was the daughter of Harriet LeBlanche Creek and William Brady Hoag, Scots-Irish. They met at a park bench not too different from this one on the old plaza at the end of the Santa Fe Trail, which was to be an enduring theme throughout their life, and at the home of the IAIA, which had drawn them to Santa Fe. They courted in the old city, and then Lillian returned to Dinahotso, New Mexico, where she was a teacher in what was then called the Indian Service and is now called the BIA. They were married a short time later beneath an oak tree on the campus of Bacon College by mutual friend, Dr. Weeks.
One of America's foremost Indian artists and my friend, Woody Crumbo.
How are you, Roy?
Fine, Woody, welcome.
Good.
Woody and I and everyone who cares about the old frontier share a special pride in Tulsa's Gilcrease Museum. Within its walls is the art to bring us a little bit closer to the Indians, trappers, buffalo, mountain men, mule skinners, prospectors, and cowboys who tried to hang on to the Old West because they knew it was something special. Now, Woody is just one of the many Indian artists whose work is shown at the Gilcrease. If our friends could get there, Woody, tell them what they'd see.
Well, Roy, besides the fine painters that you mentioned a while ago, a person going to Gilcrease would see many, many fine paintings by such Indian artists as A.C. Blue Eagle, Black Bear Bosun, Doc Tate, and many, many other fine Indian painters. And when they look at these Indian pictures, they'll see that the Indian was a very, very religious person. He loved everything about nature. He loved the skies, the grass, the trees, the rain, and the wind, and all of the things that makes up the things that we see when we look out, and we know that we take for granted, and the things that we know that are part of us and we're part of them. And those are the things that the Indian artists paint.
Well, it's beautiful. My special thanks to the Gilcrease Museum and to Woody Crumbo.
Crumbo's important friendship with Tulsa, Oklahoma oil man and philanthropist Thomas Gilcrease led to his being invited and accepting the position of artist in residence to Mr. Gilcrease in the early days of what would be known as the Gilcrease Museum, housing his extensive collection of American Indian and Western art. It was at this time that Crumbo installed a peyote bird in mural form over the main entrance.
I have the peyote bird, which is a messenger bird. The idea is that the messenger bird carries your prayers to God. When you're praying, you know, well, this messenger bird carries the prayers up to God and so on. It's a legendary, very interesting bird to draw. Of course, it's all imaginary, but one can use his imagination to draw a bird that he thinks should be the one to carry prayers. So you can make him pretty as he wants.
The pair of friends traveled together and purchased the works of art that can still be viewed at the museum.
Well, Gilcrease, yeah, he got me to come over and help him make that collection. So I told him he'd ought to get somebody else. There's more school for that, but he seemed to be set on me, so he worked on me for about a year, and I finally decided to go to work with him, help him make that collection, and we collected the old artist Taos, his Burning House, Bloom and Shine, Phelps, Kaus, Sharp, and all of those great old painters of the Taos, New Mexico area.
He became friends with all the old masters. They respected his work and knew about him, and they respected him as much as he did them. And so he would select these paintings, and then he'd call Mr. Thomas Gilcrease and the Gilcrease Foundation and Museum in Tulsa, and he would come out, and together they would purchase these pictures.
And fact is, I got from Mr. Gilcrease at one time 450 paintings from Mr. Sharp at one time, and had bought some larger works from him before, but this last purchase was made with the idea that we're going to reconstruct his studio sometime at Gilcrease Museum. And so we bought, with the collection, all of his easels and all of his paraphernalia, costumes, and everything in his studio. And so that someday will probably be reconstructed at Gilcrease. He was 97 at the time, and he wanted to see his work held together in a big museum.
He afforded them, through these purchases for the museum, a very comfortable old age.
I've got, let's see, I have 179 my original paintings are there in the Gilcrease too.
Oh,
and but they have.
What are some of them, Woody?
Oh, it's just the same as I've always done: deer and animals, dances, and ceremonies.
It was during this time when he was producing for the Gilcrease Museum that we begin to see the development and expansion of the peyote ceremony as it was brought to the Oklahoma Indians by Opyatan, or Wooden Lance, a Kiowa from western Oklahoma. This ceremony had been an important part of Woody's life for many, many years, and it was at this time he had the opportunity to put many of the ceremonies down on paper.
The next set of songs is known as the Morning Water Song. At this time of the morning, a woman brings water in, and all the prayers will be united into one focal point that reaches to the heart of our Creator. You're going all out in gratitude, in humility, and in great love that brings us to this point of the ceremony.
You see, it's a ritual that has a difference, because when you sit there in devout prayer, meditation, hear beautiful songs and the drum and the rattle going, look at the fire, the altar, and hear all of the beautiful things that the different ones say. And they place a peyote, generally a large peyote button, on the altar, and that represents Christ. And like I say, it's just practically all Christian religion.
The peyote meetings are held usually in a teepee, although it can be held in a house. And these paintings of the beautiful, intricate and accurate ceremony allows the viewer to be present during the prayer services and what many times are healing ceremonies.
So I decided that painting original pictures and selling them, I couldn't reach enough people. So I worked out a project whereby I went into silk screening some of my pictures, and then I sent those silk screens around to colleges, universities, parochial schools, junior colleges all over the United States. And so I know I reached a lot of people, and a lot of people appreciated the fact that they could, as students, miss a meal or two and buy an original silk screen or an etching. And I had the prices low enough that they were in reach of almost any student that became interested. And I think that as a result of that, when Indian art began to step up in the later years, that this had a great impact on the stimulation of interest in Indian art.
The Taos years and the development of the Taos studio of award-winning serigraphs, or silkscreen prints, were done entirely by Taos Pueblo Indians. This series began in 1948, soon after Crumbo, his wife Lillian, and children Minisa and Woody Max moved to the Taos area.
I'm old Max Evans. I met Woody Crumbo in a rather roundabout way. I was looking for a mentor in Taos. I'd moved to Taos to be a painter. There was a show by Woody Crumbo. And I was stunned. I went over and looked at those paintings, and they were so majestically beautiful, the way they were painted, and the way the light was coming in that sagebrush in the lobby. It looked like, they looked like jewels. And I knew that this was one great artist, unique, original artist.
This was to prove an enormously prolific time in the production of the serigraphs, which showed accurate detail for ceremony and regalia. At this time also, many fine copper plate etchings were produced, a process taught to Crumbo by Clayton Staples. The famous spirit horse is painted here. The important series of dancers and ceremonial serigraphs was done at this time. Crumbo and family exhibited yearly at the Gallup Ceremonial in Gallup, New Mexico.
See, everything dances, all the animals, birds, it all have dances. Everything has a dance, has a ritual and a rhythm. And it doesn't make any difference what it is. Everything that exists, and the animal, insects, birds, fish, everything dances. Everything has a ritualistic dance. The Dog Soldiers are a very interesting society of men at the time. They were kind of leaders, just like a police force around the Indians. They, in general, just looked after the welfare of the whole tribe. Of course, the Eagle Dance was made old, theoretically, to teach young, it shows the old eagle teaching a young eagle to dance, get ready to fly, and to do it through a dance. Then I like the picture of Spotted Wolf's Last Request because it shows the old burial scene of a young Sioux Indian boy that was killed in Luxembourg.
I love that.
When he was 21 years old. And he had written a letter to his folks stating that if he was killed and if they had a victory parade and all, he wanted a soldier to go first carrying the American flag in the parade. And then he wanted a cowboy to go next and lead his horse with a saddle and bridle on it. And he said, I'll be riding that horse in the victory parade. And he also expressed some love for the old ways of the Indian. So when they had this burial, they actually enacted the whole thing. When his body came back, they had this scaffold burial. And then, of course, after the Indian ceremonies, and all were finished, then the military took over and they had interned him in the military with it, military honors and attendants. He was Sioux. And when I read the letter, I decided to paint a picture, but a good many years afterward before I actually finished the picture. So I painted an awful lot of pictures, and the original belongs to the Koshari Indian Museum in Colorado, but it, right at the present time, it's on a national tour showing the Indians' participation in the wars.
The Koshari Indian Dance Group, headed by Buck Brashears, invited Crumbo to live, paint, and coach his Eagle Scouts in the La Junta, Colorado area, and it is there that Spotted Wolf's Last Request, a traditional scaffold burial scene, is in their permanent collection.
I do lots of designing in my pictures for the simple reason that I need the line, color, rhythm, design, and balance. And there are so many concepts of different designs that goes into Indian art. The sun, moon, the stars, clouds, rain, all of those things, the earth, the trees, water, and all those things are symbolic.
Well, my name's Chris Baker, and I was a Koshari that graduated in 1980. And I'm the son of Galen Baker, and I have five brothers and one sister. And we grew up around the Kasharis, and we grew up around beautiful people like Buck Brashears and like Woody Crumbo and so many others of those great people that influenced our lives. And one of the most important things I learned from Woody Crumbo, one of the most important things I learned from my dad, and one of the most important things I learned from the Southwest is an appreciation for art, appreciation for nature, appreciation and respect for God. And every time I went out with Woody Crumbo, I remember several times being out on the canyons, and it seemed there was a special way that he touched the earth. There was a special respect that he had for the trees and the rocks. And he shared this with my father, and he shared this with other people here in Kashari's.
I do remember his frequent travels to Lahana and to visit Buck and also the Kashari's and to talk to the troop in a group setting. But it was just one of those, at the time you don't think about how wonderful it is and how fortunate you are to meet some of the people. I mean, Woody Crumbo, you think of Carl Parlaska, those folks that were instrumental in making the Kashari's what they are today. You don't have an appreciation until you leave and you start thinking about these people and how great they were and how influential they were in the development and the growth of the Kashari Indian dancers.
I think the most important thing to the Kasharis about Woody Crumbo is that he honored us with his heritage and his knowledge of the Indian people, his people, and to know that we were doing the right thing to honor the American Indians with his guidance. And he kind of validated what the Kashari Indian dancers did and what they were about. And he made us feel like what we were doing was important for the Indian culture. And it was an honor for us to have a man of his integrity and his artistic abilities, because he could do anything artistically, Indian art, that I, you know, that anybody I've ever seen. But to know that he moved to Lahana to be a part of us and to help us expand this beautiful culture was such an honor to us, and we will always treasure his memory.
My name is Richard Maloof. I'm a Lahana person. I'm a member of the Kashari Indians from 1970 to 1976. I met Woody Crumbo many, many times. I'm in the same era as Paul Cedillo and John Gonzalez. I have at least 10 Woody Crumbo numbered and signed prints or sketches. To come up here to the Kiva and see you and Woody Crumbo's granddaughter and to meet all the people, it's just a wonderful experience. And the whole world loves Woody Crumbo.
Crumbos were great. It's great fun to have them here in town, both Woody Sr. and Jr. and Mrs. Crumbo. We all enjoyed having them here. They taught us a lot. Very, very valuable. We all appreciate all their artwork, all the things they've done. They're valuable parts of all of our collection. We're so appreciative for that kind of education that we're able to get here in Lahontan.
Hello, I'm Jim Halsey. I'm honored to be a part of the Crumbo family. I married Minisa Crumbo, Woody's daughter. I've always been a fan of Woody Crumbo art, and I have so much respect for Woody's creativity and the fact that he developed processes of silk screening and etching that made Indian art affordable. Woody is a member of the Oklahoma Hall of Fame. He also received an honorary doctorate degree at Oklahoma City University. Woody was also gracious enough to let us use his masterpiece, Eagle Dancer, as our company logo. And we took multiples of it around the country as we presented our various shows and programs worldwide.
Cimarron, New Mexico was Woody and Lillian's last home, studio, and gallery. It was near to the Mystic Mine in Eagle Nest, New Mexico, Taos, New Mexico, La Junta, Colorado, and Oklahoma. It is also home of the Philmont Scout Ranch. It was here that the Chief Speaks, the Returning War Party, and Spirit Talk was painted. It was through art education, opportunities, friends, family. And many others who helped him out, Indian way. That Woody became a loyal light of truth, helping each of us to open the door to humanity's future destiny. And it was here on April 4th, 1989, that he rose, as usual, to greet the sun, and began his long canoe journey to the west. Shuman Dagsuin, Odopi, a blessing has been visited upon us here. Miigwech, Wimene, Kichi Miigwech.